school website.
Good evening, I'm calling this meeting to order. Noted public notice of this meeting was posted at the school district office and website, all school buildings, the Lodi Enterprise, the Portage Daily Register, the Lodi City Hall, Lodi Town Hall, the Dane Village Hall, and Dane Township Hall, West Point Town Hall, Vienna Town Hall, Lodi Public Library, and mailed to clerks in Arlington, Decorah, and Roxbury Townships.
Motion to adjourn to closed session pursuant to Wisconsin Statute Sections 19.851C and F to consider employment and compensation and performance evaluation data and initial review specific personnel issues.
Second.
Beers, Whipperfirth. We'll do a roll call, starting with Mark.
Yes.
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 And yes, the motion carries 7-0. We are in closed session.
While you're out, close the door.
Yeah.
You still have my job.
Did you get in, Mark?
I got in, I just...
Her diploma until she's gone.
Yeah.
Okay, good evening. We are already in open session. First item is approval of the agenda.
Motion to approve agenda.
A second.
Westfall Ricks, all in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next is taking positive steps with service award.
Yes, we have actually two of them to present tonight, but one of them is for Brent Richter, who is our business manager, and Brent is taking time out to be with his father and take a little trip that they had planned over a year ago. And for those that may or may not know, Brent is leaving us at the end of this contract year and is going to be taking on a new responsibility in a new district. And I just wanted to say, in recognition of all the outstanding things that Brent has brought to our district, that we appreciate him. So we had prepared and put together a Taking Positive Steps of Service Award for him. So at least, if nothing else, he gets public recognition, even though he's not here to accept the little piece of paper in his 100,000 grand bar.
Okay. I'll take that for him.
Take that for him? It's not for you. The second one is, if I could have Christy Paskey come forward. Christy is a math teacher at Lodi High School, and she was nominated for this award due to her willingness to go above and beyond to help our students. Christy has spent a lot of time with our needy math students and our special education students, and numerous times I've heard her name come up from the standpoint of how much kids appreciate her, how willing she is to bend over backwards to make sure that they get the concepts and they're able to be successful in math, which is not my favorite subject or my best subject either. So if a struggling math students get caught up and they have pressing needs, she stays there to help them, helps them get caught up in other classes as well. She has willingly taken students who struggle with the English language and even sits in some of our Spanish classes during her prep time to improve her Spanish skills. And this has come in very handy. We've had a Spanish teacher out, and we've had to do some translation or make some communication with some of our ELL students. Christy is also one of the teachers who proposed a new personal finance class that we'll be instituting next year. She wrote a grant to try to help fund this curriculum and offset some of the cost. And hopefully, Lodi will ultimately win this grant, but it was probably due to the total effort of Christy in terms of putting all that effort together and putting it in the form of the grant application in the first place. Secondly, she's also going to be taking on a new class next year in terms of accounting. So she stepped forward in so many different ways that we just decided that she needed to have, in recognition of her outstanding service to the students, the staff, and the greater Lodi community, a TOPS award. So on behalf of the school board, on behalf of the staff and the administration, here's your TOPS award, and sorry, Riggs, and a 100 grand bar for all of your efforts, okay? You bet.
Thank you, I guess. I think the biggest thing is the Spanish stuff that I did wouldn't be possible without Michelle Bravik, because I think it's hard to have another high school teacher in your classroom every day when you're teaching in class, and she always let me come in. She always would help me just as much as the students, and I just give her a lot of credit for doing that, because I don't think that could be an easy task to take on. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We do not have any presentations this evening, so the next is public input. comes up on my screen. There we go. Yep. The purpose of the citizen input agenda item is for the public to provide comments on any agenda item or to publicly address the Board of Education on items that pertain to school business. The amount of time allotted to each speaker will generally not exceed 5 minutes per person to allow all people who wish to speak an opportunity to be heard. However, I may modify the time limits at my discretion. If the speaker has questions for the Board, they will be duly noted and responses will be provided in an appropriate manner. But the Board cannot respond to individual questions or individual comments as part of the public input agenda item. As an additional reminder, the Board cannot take action on any item that is brought forth during the public input session or on any item that was not posted on the meeting agenda. Citizen input is an important part of the Board meeting agenda, and the Board appreciates hearing from the community on issues concerning them and our school district. If there's anyone here this evening that would like to come forward to the table with the mic and address the Board at this time, please come forward and state your name and your item of concern. Okay, not seeing any. We're next going to go to the consent agenda. On the consent agenda this evening is approval of the minutes of the May 9th regular Board meeting, vouchers, fundraiser requests, the middle school and music department, sales of wrapping paper, chocolate pizza, and gift items for October 31st through November 11th of 2016. Middle school music department sales of bulbs, pizza, and chocolate for March 6th through March 17th of 2017, and a Thailand fundraiser. Fundraiser reports this evening, we have the softball fundraiser for Geo Garden, baseball fundraiser for Hit-A-Thon, and chip shop fundraiser. Field trip requests are for the FFA to the Wisconsin State Fair Discovery Barn, August 6th through the 8th, and the office, FFA Officer Retreat on July 11th through the 13th of 2016. Under other, we have WIA High School Membership Renewal, the Middle School Discipline Report, and an Open Enrollment Denial. Under Resignations and Retirements, we have a resignation of an Elementary School Special Ed Assistant, an Elementary School Teacher, the Business Manager, the Food Service Mail Person, High School Counselor, High School Social Studies, High School Assistant Volleyball Coach, Swing Team Personnel, and a Volunteer Football Coach. Under co-curricular, we have contracts out to dance team advisors, one at 75% and one at 25%. Girls basketball coaches, a head high school assistant coaches, three of them, and a high school volunteer, middle school head and middle school three assistant girl basketball coaches. Boys basketball coaches, we have a high school head coach and assistant coaches. There's three of them, plus a volunteer coach. A middle school head coach and a middle school assistant coach. There's two of those. Volleyball, a high school assistant and a middle school head coach. And boys soccer, preseason facility use request. Under community program, the crew, we have eight people being offered job offerings, and two are for the pool in addition to that. Regular staff, summer custodial crew, five of them, summer technology assistant, one, OSC intervention assistant, and a food service, mail service staff job offering. Under personnel other, we have leave without pay requests. Eleven of them, and nine people requesting vacation rollover requests. Is there anybody that would like any of the agenda items pulled for individual approval. If not...
I move to approve the consent agenda as presented with the addition of the approval of the FFA Wisconsin State Fair Discovery Barn, August 6th, 8th, 2016, and FFA Officers Retreat, July 11th to 13th, 2016. Approval of the Thailand trip fundraiser and approval of the of Casey Brunig and Carter Brunig for the crew pool. Approval of the resignation of swing team Lewis Barron and resignation of volunteer football coach Derek Birchborn.
I will second.
Beers, was it Seidler? Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. So all those items I read have been approved by the board. Moving on to the agenda, we have first item is the district facility study review.
This is just primarily an information update, and facility committee can fill in some of the voids that I may have forgotten to include. Obviously, the recommendation that came out of the facility community committee involved the possible building of a new facility. With that, you can't build a facility if you don't have a site. So the administration was authorized to begin to look at different sites. We have done so. I provided a report to the facility committee at our last meeting about the ones that we're looking at. There are potentially four different sites, two of which seem to have the biggest appeal at this particular point in time. We have talked with those owners, both of which are willing to discuss further and negotiate a potential sale of those properties. If that were to happen and the board were to zero in on one of those sites, that would involve an action at a annual meeting. And then obviously the funding for that would have to go through some sort of a referendum process. So the juncture being is that we need to arrive at what it's going to be, which site would best serve us. So in that regard, I have a meeting set up with city officials on this Thursday, actually, Thursday morning. We're going to talk about all the different details that would involve extension of services, cost factors, hydrology studies, things like that, that may be involved with one or more of those sites, and see if we can get sort of an estimate about what would be involved in order to take one versus the other. The other thing that we did also is to set up basically a test on the site where the current elementary school exists, which is the one right next to us. And we're going to do borings on that site to determine whether there is a feasibility to expand or extend that building one direction or the other, and if so, how far. And if not, then we'll at least have that data in, as a knowledge base for us. So right now, that's where we're at. In other action, the facility committee on Tuesday, June 7th, at their last meeting, did make a motion to proceed with the repair of the
High school parking lot,
and also to revamp the entire high school site with LED lighting, both inside and outside. The lighting at the high school will be paid out of remaining funds from this year's maintenance and operation budget, with any overlay or additional funding that's necessary to come out of the 2016-17 maintenance and operations budget. And then the money for the high school parking lot repairs to the tune of $156,000 that will be taken out of Fund 41, which is our capital improvement fund. So those are the two actions basically that were forwarded to the board for action here. Otherwise, the rest of it is just for information. So the action regarding the LED lighting retrofitting and the action on the high school parking lot repairs. Am I correct, Mark?
That's correct, and that's... The LED lights are the payback on that program is very high, as you can probably imagine. So it's the right decision to do. The high school parking lot was the item that that was identified as the most critical. There were other critical items as well, but this is the only one that we can afford at this time. So this will utilize not all, but most of the 2016-2017 funds.
I'll make a motion to approve the recommendation from the Facilities Committee to install both internal and external LED lighting at the high school and to, where'd it go? Just left
down
me.
At the bottom.
And to maintain the parking lot at the high school.
I'll second.
Rick Spear, discussion?
The reason why the high school, that portion of the high school parking lot was the most critical is, as was explained to us, if you remember the first year of the current referendum, we did have some work that was done in the in that parking lot where there was a lot of excessive moisture, and if we don't do this, we're going to lose what we've done. So that's how this one was brought to the surface. The other items, of course, were the roofs, the middle school parking lot, as well, and also with that, there were some other items that were identified with three other with two other buildings, the one building that we're in, and then of course the elementary school. And those, because the future of those of these two buildings are unknown, those items were tabled. So we just looked at items from the middle school and the high school. That was our method, at least.
Makes sense.
Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next we have Chromebook Policies and Procedure Handbook.
Yeah, I'm going to ask Joe to come up because he's been involved with the tech committee and help foster these modifications and changes.
So you have received this earlier, at least just to look through. So this is the Chromebook policies and procedures that will be handed out to all students and families at the beginning of next year, as well as the one-to-one Chromebook user agreement, just a single sheet of paper. So I guess any questions on what you saw or concerns? Certainly,
the time it takes to
Think I give Tyler all the credit on this. He really worked hard and looked at other districts, and we revised and, you know, customized. But Tyler did the lion's share of the work.
That's good.
Did you just make it?
I'll make a motion to accept.
Oh, yeah. Carl, start talking. But you just kind of.
Oh.
You doing it?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, say it.
No, will you second? Oh.
I'll second.
Well, who said the motion?
I did.
Did you say it all? Okay.
Blow down it. Don't worry about it.
She's listening to him.
I'm just
going to say it. So who seconded it?
I'll second.
Westfall Pair, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Anybody? Motion carries 7-0.
You've been left out, right?
Are you in the room?
I don't think. It's just like at home.
Nick's staffing budget plan.
We have two different things to cover, but the first one is our special education plan, and then Tiffany put this together, so I'm going to turn it over and let her cover that first, and then we'll talk about how that interfaces with the overall staffing plan for next year.
Okay. The Finance Committee has heard this little spiel already, but I wanted to share all the same information with the full board so that everyone is on the same page. And I did make a few edits to the last few slides, so it might look different than what you had in your packet, just by a little bit. But the information's the same, I just didn't have some of the wording. So, I guess we start by looking at, in special education across our whole district, we obviously are always trying to look at what's best for kids. And what we want for kids is we want consistent staff, and for kids more opportunities to work with educational professionals, meaning teachers, and opportunities to learn with their peers as much as possible. We're getting to a point in the district where we have a lot of part-time educational assistants, and it's getting to the point where it's getting hard to manage so many adults that are on a shortened day, per se, in terms of not being there full-time. So we're trying to look at how can we rectify the situation. And also, I did some research with other school districts, in our area, mostly Dane County schools, some of our in our conference as well, and their caseloads at the elementary level, some caseloads are for students in Middleton, up to possibly seven students in Monona Grove and Wanakee, and we're at about 12 across the board, some more, some less, but at the elementary, across the board, at least 12 for each special ed teacher. And we've gotten an influx, and I think this isn't a lot different from other school districts that I've talked to at directors of people service meetings that we have in the area, influx of special needs students, and that there's been more, this year in particular, more referrals across the whole district than we've had in previous years. So, and some of the students who have transferred in have pretty significant needs. And we already have three kids coming in next year that have some significant needs that are going to require more support. So my goal in this whole proposal is to be able to do these things, but hopefully with not a lot more money, and just by reallocating money that we already have in special ed. So I'll show you the details. So this is kind of why change is necessary. A big part of this too is that we have right now, if I didn't make any changes to special ed staffing for next year, I have 5 part-time EA openings right now for the fall. So we're already talking about 5 new people across the district. And what we're running into is we are constantly, obviously people want full-time work, generally speaking. We do have a few educational assistants that they're moms, it works in their schedule, they want to be on their kids' schedule, you know, they're relatively educated, they're great with kids, but that's not always the case. And a lot of people want full-time work, so as soon as they find it, they're gone. And then we struggle, and we put in a lot of man hours of getting something posted, getting an interview team together, and then when they start, we often will hire a sub for the special education teacher so they can train that person, and even a day or two of training is not enough. So they're not coming in August where we can do all of our standard training with them. So there's a lot of man hours across the whole district when we're trying to fill an open spot. So right now, that's how many openings I just have for next year. So we also have increasing caseloads, which I mentioned a little bit earlier, and we have some transient students, but some new students with some significant behavioral needs. Some special education teacher burnout. You know that there's been a resignation in the school district, and primarily because there's challenging kids every single year, and it's hard to keep up the pace with those kids every single year, especially when you have 12 kids and families and therapists and teachers and assistants to manage. So, and the level of the number of educational assistants, it gets harder and harder to manage so many adults working with so many kids, and the schedules get pretty crazy. So how can this proposal help our students? My goal is to decrease our people's caseloads across the board so that we can have more teacher time with our special ed kids. So we can have educational assistants. We'll still have educational assistants. They'll still be providing wonderful service to our kids, but my goal is to not have our teachers spread so thin so that more kids can get better service. One thing we ran into at the elementary school this year is that a lot of kids, because they were spread out across so many different classrooms, were getting pulled out, like for their reading instruction, pulled out of their regular classroom. Not all of those students needed that support. Some of them could have benefited from being in their classroom and learning with their peers, but because of our staffing, we had to organize it. We have to meet their minutes in the IEP, so we therefore would pull a group out because there's no way we had enough people to get where they needed to be. So we're also looking at restructuring the schedule of the elementary school, restructuring how we place students in classrooms. We're just overall trying to see how can we be more efficient and provide services. I think we provide wonderful service, so I'm not saying that we don't provide great service now, but I think we can make it more efficient. And I always just throw in planning time. If you ever want to come shadow a special education teacher, especially in grades K through 5, you'll see that they usually have like few minutes to sit down and eat lunch, but otherwise they don't have the standard prep time that every other teacher has, because if a kid goes off or is throwing something across the classroom, well, they are the ones who are going to get called in to help with that. And obviously they can't say, oh no, I'm not going to come help, I'm eating my lunch right now. It just doesn't work that way. So hopefully maybe build in some planning time for those, especially K-5 people as well. Other piece is that there's a new state mandate. This next year it's kind of a pilot, and then the following year it's a mandate that any student that has a reading goal in their IEP, that we have to progress monitor them frequently to determine if they're making progress. So usually when the state comes in and does a special ed audit, they just look at paperwork. Are you doing your paperwork correctly? Are teachers turning things in on time? Do parents get information in a timely manner? But a new piece of that in the coming years will be exactly how much progress are your kids who need reading support, exactly how much progress are they making? So we need to be able to work with those small groups of students and prove that they're making significant progress. So will this cost money? Yes. But the majority of the funds are being reallocated within the special education budget. So I'm just going to look at each school now. This is just a snippet of information from each school. So currently at the primary OSC building, we have 2 full-time special ed teachers, 6 part-time EAs, 1 full-time EA. We're looking at, because we have a smaller number of 4K kids coming in next year, that we're going to have a half-time, oops, sorry, I should have that. Sorry, should have been had that in the beginning. So this just kind of gives you what we currently have. So we're looking at taking one of our teachers that teaches 4K, also is special ed certified. So half of her day is going to be teaching 4K, and the other half of her time would be early childhood special education. So it's essentially increasing the special ed teacher FTE at the primary OSC by 0.5, but not really increasing overall costs, because obviously we paid her full-time last year. So not a huge cost there. We'd eliminate 2 part-time EA positions, increase 1 of the remaining positions to full-time, and then keep the remaining 3 part-time EA positions for a little bit of a savings. The elementary school plan, we currently have 14 part-time EAs, and this is just special education, so not library or any of the other regular education positions. We currently have 4 special education teachers. The goal will be to eliminate 6 part-time EA positions and increase 2 remaining EA positions to full-time. Add 1 full-time teacher and keep the remaining 6 part-time EA positions for a total cost of $7,500, approximately. Middle school plan, we currently have 9 part-time EA positions. We currently have 4 special education teachers. We'd eliminate 2 EA positions, increase 1 existing EA position to full-time, and add 1 full-time teacher and keep the remaining 5 part-time EAs. So a little bigger number on that one, $47,000 approximately. And the high school plan would be to eliminate 1 EA position, add 1 full-time teacher that would primarily deal with transition services, so students that are in our 18 to 21-year-old program, and then also some of our 12th graders who will be merging into that program. As you know, special education students can stay in school until age 21. It's usually a relatively small number that do, but we also have kids that are off-site and alternate placements. We also, this person's job would also to be find some job placements for kids in our 18 to 21-year-old program, which are currently things that I do right now. Keep the remaining, they already have 3 full-time EAs at the high school, so we'd keep those 3 full-time EAs and the remaining 4 part-time EAs. Again, cost of about $42,000. So the total cost of the staffing plan is about $88,000, but we have about $50,000 of it from being reallocated due to an alternate placement for a student that's no longer existing this next school year. So we have about $38,000 that's not covered within this plan. Funding sources, we have flow-through funds, which are special education funds, and that's where this money is coming out of that we were using to fund an alternate placement for a student for the last several years. And this is one of those situations where when the state looks at how much money you're spending in special education from one year to the next, you have to continue to spend that same amount of money in order to retain maintenance of effort. So unless you lose a really high need student, then you can argue why you would spend less. But so we still have the student that it was in an alternate placement, but he's going to be in a different type, our 18 to 21-year-old program now, instead of an alternate placement. So theoretically, we need to continue to spend that money. That student is still on our rolls. It hasn't decreased. His needs have changed. He's improved a lot, but he'll still be part of our programming, so we haven't lost him. Transfer of service, that's another small, it's really not money coming into our district, but allows us to increase our revenue cap. If we have students, for example, we've had several students come from other districts this year. If we incur specific costs, say we hire an EA just to be with one student who's come in and has needs, we can use that to increase our revenue cap. So that's something that ties into this formula as well. And then in talking with Brent, we talked about
you know, how can we cover this part that's not covered? And he said, you know, several of the things we've been looking at are, could this be a bridge year until the referendum, that that could be included in operating costs for the future referendum, the existing, like, $38,000. Questions?
So it looks like you're losing about half an FTE. Is that correct?
Losing in teachers?
Right, because I have minus 20 and plus 20s for each position. I'm assuming 20 hours for a half-time. Are they more than that, less than that?
Their hours are like 28 hours per week. We keep them under 30, yeah. It's like 28.75.
Okay, so then a concern is that, I mean, the prep time and the planning, get it, but are we concerned at all about less face time with the students? Because you're going to have less bodies.
We are going to have less bodies, correct. And I still need to evaluate with our three students coming in. Again, they haven't filled out enrollment paperwork, but I've gotten calls from the district saying the student is coming to you. Before I eliminate any EA positions, I will have to look at, make sure that the needs of those students are covered. But my hope is that having some of those full-time people in there, what we always run into is there's a shortage of people to get kids off the bus in the morning and a shortage of people getting kids on the bus in the afternoon. That bit of time, because again, if they're 5.75, they either start early and end early, or they start a little later and end a little later. So we always have those gaps in time. So my hope is that those full-time people can help in that regard. The other piece is that the way we schedule kids into classrooms and the way we look at the schedule in terms of trying to maybe not schedule reading at the same time across the board for the whole school, because then we have special education kids spread out in 12 or 15 different classrooms, but staggering that so that we can service it a little more efficiently. Mm-hmm. So all of those pieces. But you're right, we will have fewer bodies, correct?
The HR aspect, I get it, understand it, I live with it too. My concern is, what if the referendum fails? What are we going to do then? Because we're going to put this new structure into place. Again, I think it makes sense. I just think maybe it's wise, and maybe next month if you can bring to the board an alternative just in case something here doesn't work. Because with this type of program, I don't think that we can't afford not to have a plan B. That's my only concern. But I can tell you put a lot of time and into it, and it's definitely needed. There's no doubt about it. I just think we have to prepare for something else just in case.
Yep, absolutely.
It's probably another way of asking what Mark was asking, but what is it? You had mentioned the caseload was 12 students. Does this change that?
12 or more. It would put teachers at about 7. Okay. So my goal of covering kids would be that their coverage is going to be more teacher time rather than educational assistant time. So if I have 7 kids and they're split between 2 classrooms or 3 classrooms, that narrows how many different places I need to be in. And the hope is that then that teacher can be in the classroom more supporting that student rather than pulling kids out if they don't necessarily need that support. And some kids do. If they're reading 4 grade levels below, then we have to make sure we're giving them intensive reading intervention too. So it makes sense sometimes to have kids in a small group outside their classroom, but sometimes it makes sense to have them in their classroom.
You also mentioned that you know that there's 3 more coming in. How do you know that? Is that through 4K?
Nope. They're from other districts and from parent phone calls. Yeah.
Okay.
One for sure that's coming from a district that we already have paperwork on, but the other two have just been, the students coming your way, parents already said they're moving there. I've talked with parents. They said, yes, we're moving. But we don't have enrollment paperwork yet.
Got it. Off the top of your head, if you don't have it, that's fine. Compared to today, percent of special needs compared to like maybe 5 years ago, we are going up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think we're about 14% right now, which is really high, I think.
Is it? Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I will say that fortunately or unfortunately, we seem to have a very good reputation in terms of special ed services out in the community. So we often have people say, well, I talked to so-and-so and they think, you know, as evidenced by, you know, a family this year that we didn't have any room in open enrollment. And they said, okay, we'll sell our house and move in then. Sight unseen, hadn't met teachers, nothing. So it's.
That's a testament to the program and all the people that are in the program.
It is, yeah.
So, no doubt about it.
Any other questions? Thank you for all your work, Tiffany.
Yep. Thank you. Thank you for considering this proposal.
In correlation with that is obviously the staffing of our regular programs, which I've kind of laid out for the board. When we passed our last referendum, one of the things that we focused attention on was keeping quality staff in the classroom, keeping the educational programs that we had in place. Over the last couple of years, we've tried a little bit different approach to budgeting, saying that we don't have any additional funds, but how can we better utilize the funds that we do have, which when we went back to the staff and said, what is going to make your job easier? How is it going to, how can we benefit staffing in this district that will focus on the board literacy, reading, integration of technology goals that were set for the coming year? That resulted in two positions, the tech integrator and the literacy coach being added. But it was all done with internal funds. In other words, we reappropriated, pulled from here, pulled from there. I have to give the building administrators credit. We took money from anywhere that we could possibly find it to free up in order to fund those positions. So we did not, quote, exceed what our goal was in terms of a balanced budget for this year. Coming into next year, we did the same kind of approach. We went back out and said, okay, what kinds of things do you need in order to, quote, focus on instruction in the classroom and make your job, you know, more functional and, again, still address those goals that we have on the table of literacy, reading, and technology. And out of that grew one of the major things that we have kind of curtailed is our LMC support. So one of the things that popped to the top is having a full-time LMC person in each of the buildings. And looking at our budgetary situation, that's impossible to do. But with Linda Brokish, who's been a part-time person the last few years, and with Peggy Schaub, who has also been part-time for the last few years, we kind of took money that Linda would leave behind by not being here, and then looked at reappropriating some money out of the, quote, LMC funding, because we get funding, what's called the Common School Fund, and we also appropriate a certain amount of fund, about $31,000 of Fund 10, in order to accommodate our LMC program. So essentially what we're doing is we're pulling money out of our Fund 10 and we're reappropriating money to go toward hiring a full-time person, 6-12, as an LMC person, and then moving Peggy's time up in order to accommodate the K-5 programming and offer more LMC support to our teachers so that they can take kids in to the LMC. The LMC person can come into the classroom, conduct reading lessons, et cetera, and kind of what I would call support and help the literacy initiative that we have in the district. Anything and everything that we've done up to this point in time has been big borrowing and stealing money from existing budgets in order to make it happen. But as we move forward, we've kind of reached a point where the staffing plan that I put in front of you for next year, we can accommodate it. It's going to be a little bit over, like, Tiffany was talking about, a little bit over what we have available in terms of funds, but it's still within the parameters of 3 years ago when we budgeted 3 years forward, we were going to be about $200,000 in arrears this year in order to keep our staffing in place. And that's kind of the target that we had in place, and that's kind of where we're at. I understand where Mark is coming from, and I understand, you know, his issues is what are we going to do? I'm looking at right now is what do we do in order to put the best staffing in place and to provide the best programming possible in terms of classroom support for next year. I believe that we have to address that issue that Mark is talking about, but we need to come up with a plan. If a referendum doesn't pass, I mean, in this case, an operating referendum, I'm not talking about facilities or those other things that apply. We all need to come to grips with what is it then that we're not going to have that we have now, but how are we still going to try to avoid affecting that classroom situation? Where if we put these people in place, you don't put them in place and then turn around and pull them back out if you feel that that's important to a delivery of a good program. So what else then is going to have to disappear? That means what is not mandated? Or we have to spell out to the community in clear expectation form and format, just as we tried to do the last time, why we need this money moving forward. And that's where the $950,000 that we've had in place for the last 3 years have been used. They've been used for technology things, they've been used for maintenance things, but most importantly, they've been used to keep the programs and staffing in place that we've currently had. So I would say that Mark's question is very valid. But part of my funding proposal for staffing, along with Tiffany's funding proposal, is to say that we put a moratorium on any staffing except in cases where it's legislated, where we have no choice about it because the legislature says you have to do this. Or each time that there is a retirement or a resignation, we look at it from the standpoint of, do we have to replace this person or do we not have to replace this person in terms of our student populations? And then look at it from that standpoint, but not add any more staffing other than what we are going to put in place moving forward for next year, which we feel is necessary and needed, just as Tiffany is saying is necessary and needed in the special ed. These are the things that staff say they need in order to offer a quality program. And next year's kids deserve that just as much as last year's kids or the year before that. So that's kind of where we are. And I'm more than willing to try to answer questions. I'm sure Tiffany will as well about the proposals that we have on the table.
And I'll just add one comment that obviously before I would hire all of my teacher positions, I would analyze carefully if I needed more hands on deck at the elementary school and it meant I couldn't eliminate all six TAs, then I would have to look at within this amount of money, do I have, you know, because if I think, nope, I get five more new students, whatever it might be, I need to make sure I have enough TAs, obviously, and that means then I didn't fill one of the other positions, that may mean what it is. I would, again, try and make a careful decision based on all the information that I had.
So anyway, with that kind of an outline, I guess what we're asking for is approval to move forward with this staffing plan, understanding that we are aligned with what our three-year projection was and what our deficit budget was going to be for this year, which is in that $200,000 range. It's not exactly where or close to where we said we were going to be given the circumstances of our three-year non-recurring referendum. The other side of the coin is that going forward, we have to build a case for keeping those things in place, but we have to build it with the community and a clear understanding about why they're there and what money is needed in order to keep that moving forward as well. And if it doesn't fly, as Mark said, we have to take a look at a lot of different things outside the box in terms of how do we keep an educational program going, but still funded. Okay.
I'll make a motion that we approve the staffing plan as proposed.
I'll second.
Riggs Westfall, discussion?
I think one of the things that this is all good information, but for me, and I wasn't on the board at the time, but you guys did a great job of getting out and getting the last referendum passed. And to me, that was kind of a mandate from the public that said, go operate these schools for the next 3 years. I think pulling the reins up in the last year is not what we should be doing. I think what we should be doing is progressing as if we're going to pass a referendum, and it's on us to make sure that we get that operational referendum passed. But the public gave us 3 years. We need to use those 3 years and make sure that those kids are getting the opportunities that they need within that. If we keep looking to the future and saying, well, what might happen, then we're going to not do the things we should be doing as our due diligence to make sure that these kids get every opportunity. So I think we have to go. We have to continue this next year out as if we have the funding.
Any other discussion? Okay, we have motion Riggs Westfall. All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next we have 8.04, compensation for labor groups.
I won't speak for the contract review committee. I will just say that the contract review committee has met with all of the labor groups. They have discussed a compensation package for each of them. I will leave it up to them to make the motion and spell that out. And if there's any questions, either one of the committee members, as we've discussed in closed session, or myself maybe can answer it if there's something else that needs to come to the table. And I'll turn it over. Are you the chair, Steve?
Sue is? The coughing one is the chair.
I am. Someone else talk.
Do you want me to do it, the motion? Or do you want to talk about it first?
You can talk.
Well, I'll go ahead and make the motion, then we can. I'll make a motion to approve a 1.5% compensation increase for all district employee groups, including administrative assistants, custodians, maintenance staff, teachers, food service staff, administrative staff, directors, technology staff, building monitors, crew employees, facility management staff, to set the and to set the base salary for a beginning teacher with a bachelor's degree at, correct me if I'm wrong here, Chuck, $37,000?
Correct.
And to set the co-curricular base at $32,250 for the 2016-17 contract year.
I'll second.
Rick's Westfall. Discussion?
Again, I think this a lot of this was information that was brought to us by the employee groups. As I understand it, we budgeted for this amount in our pre-planning, so we're not increasing anything over what we had already previously budgeted. And this falls in line with what the employee groups and the contract committee agreed to. I don't know if there's anything else to say.
Okay, any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next is health insurance contribution. Do we have the lights put back on? Please, thank you.
The district is a little bit unique from the standpoint of we have a set compensation level that we provide toward a health benefit plan, whether it's a family plan or a single plan. That has been reviewed each of the last 3 years. 1 year we made an increase, I believe it was last year if I remember correctly. Otherwise, we have reduced it we reduced it 1 year and then we did not move it at all. So it's a little bit different from the standpoint of it's a set amount, we know exactly what it is, we budget accordingly. And again, the contract review committee has talked about it, the board has discussed it, and it's open for discussion and or a motion to determine what that set amount is going to be for the 2016-17 school year. We do have Brianna's here from 3, M3. If there's any questions relative to the health insurance plan or some of the things that were discussed through the health insurance committee, she certainly could potentially answer some of those if you were so desirous. Okay.
I would be interested in that information as to whether or not they changed their health care or how they changed it.
This is Brianna Hillenbrand. She works for M3, which is our insurance consulting firm, which works with our insurance committee and the staff to try to determine what we can do in order to keep health costs down and still provide a quality benefit for our employees. So, Brianna?
Yes, thank you for having me. Can you hear me? So, would you like me to just explain a little bit about what's happened this renewal?
Please.
And why we got the increase that we're getting, and I can talk a little bit about, if you want, just contribution models, you know, premium contribution models at other districts. But I'll start with just a brief history on the renewal a little bit. We've been working, and you should know that the insurance committee works very hard and very dedicated people, great questions, and I really enjoy working with them. We've had some challenging years, claims-wise, the last few years here at Lodi. I've been working with you, I think, right after Act 10. The last couple of years, we've just had some really difficult claims, meaning we've had a lot of high-cost claimants and then just a lot of just high cost in general and high utilization with our program. A lot of things we took a lot of time identifying to try and determine how we can prevent these things moving forward, what kind of plan design changes we can make. And unfortunately for us, a lot of the high-cost claimants and the issues have been unavoidable. So as a result, I think it's been really challenging, you know, each year for staff to deal with the increases. And obviously how we're set up, we have the defined premium contribution, as Chuck talked about, so it's that set amount. Well, I know that's challenging for staff each year, you know, to try and they're kind of waiting on pins and needles to say, oh, gosh, what's our renewal going to go up this year? And we all know that medical costs, you know, continue to go up. I will say that, you know, while medical trend has stayed pretty flat, at anywhere from 6 to 8%. Prescription drugs, and I'm sure we all hear about it on the news, and prescription drugs, the costs are just skyrocketing. And so as a result, our high-cost claims are expensive, you know, obviously just for medical and for the facility, but the drugs that are associated with those claims are incredibly expensive. So as a result, I spent a lot of time, and I called in every favor I had to WEA this year for Lodi because, again, we were trending very high, and they were going to release initially a very, very high double-digit increase. It could have been anywhere from, you know, 17 to 18%, and I'm like, it's unacceptable. We can't handle that here in Lodi. And I explained to them how we're set up and our structure. And so this went on for several months, and you know, I really pushed to get it as low as I possibly could, and at the end of the day, they released an 8.5. We did have an option to look at that would reduce our costs further by making additional plan design changes, whether it was changing the deductible or taking copays higher. But we did, each year we do a survey, and staff has a chance that the survey comes out of our committee, and staff has a chance to vote on that. And the staff voted to keep everything the same and accept the 8.5% renewal. So that kind of sets the stage for you a little bit, hopefully, and answers those questions of kind of how we've been doing this past renewal season.
Thank you for coming tonight to speak to us.
Yes.
The 8.5%, what would it have been with the alternative plan?
6.5.
And do you know what the percent of the body voted to
Ooh.
Keep it?
Mo, do you remember? It was overwhelming. I thought it was almost 70%.
It was bigger than we've had in the past vote on it.
So it was a large majority.
Overwhelming.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
I have a question. So talks about the adding $750 to the family plan, the contribution rate, et cetera. Conversely, if you add $500 contribution to the single plan, there's only one possibility there, and I'm wondering why that is. There's only one possibility to adding to the single plan for the new distribution rate as opposed to the
I'll
family plan. Oh, okay, thank you.
It's primarily because the cost, there's significant more cost with a family plan from the standpoint of offsetting the cost. In order to keep the percentage equal, the 500% would essentially offset the higher $1,200 family plan at the same percentage level. In other words, you would be receiving about if you use the percentage, about 75% of your cost would be absorbed by the district, the other 25% you would be paying. On a single plan, because it's a single individual, our user rates were different, so the rates did not go up the same amount for a single plan as they went up for family plans. And that's where most of our costs were incurred, is family situations that had, I would say, serious illnesses, birth situations, all of which contributed to those costs. And most of those 8.5% costs are in family plans, not in single plans.
Right. All school districts have many more family contracts than single contracts, and so that's where the bulk of, obviously, the cost is. So, okay. Good question.
And that's why there's only one, because the $500 would offset at the same percentage. Okay. Any number other than the $1,200 is going to be a higher percentage of contribution on the part of the employee for a family plan versus a single plan.
Okay. Thank you. I don't know if you want me to, I mean, I'm happy to speak to you. You know, I work with all districts. I have a few municipality clients that I work with, but mostly districts. And, you know, obviously unique, Lodi is a bit unique that you do the defined contribution and that set amount. A lot of districts, you know, even neighboring districts around you are doing the percentage. Most of them are at 12.6%. So after Act 10, they adopted what the state was going to do at 12.6. I know that with our defined contribution, we hover right around 20%. I think it's pretty close to that as a percentage. So just, you know, an FYI, you know, of what's going on in the neighboring districts. And I know it's always a challenge. I had shared some of this information with Brent, where I had put together, you know, what plan designs look like around, you know, at the other districts, and what, you know, the premium contribution looks like. And I know, you know, this has come up in a lot of meetings, that guys are a great district, and you do a wonderful job with new teachers, and you spend the money to train, and then you lose them to some of those neighboring larger districts, to a Middleton, to a Verona, to a Wanakee, and that's a big challenge. And so that's just something, you know, I said that I'm very happy to work with the committee or any of you moving forward. If you want some more, you know, information, I'm happy to provide that about what some of the other districts are doing around you. And if you want to take a look at your contribution model, I'd be happy to work through that with you. So I just want to make sure I offer that up, because we do want to start doing some longer term strategic planning to make sure that, you know, you're positioned where you want to be. No.
I just want to comment on, we just filled a special education position at the elementary school, and I know quite a few people in special ed, so I called a few people in other districts and said, hey, we have this position open, it's a great district, you're going to want to be here, I'm sure we can at least match what you're already making, okay, well, send me the information, send me the details, and we had just agreed on what our plan was going to be, the survey had just come out, and I said, here's the information. That's $3,800 more per year than I spend right now, Tiffany. There's no way I would look at your district. So when you're not even just talking about retention of people that are already here, but recruitment. We have to, and that's why I've been emailing back and forth with Brianna too, like I hope our insurance committee is going to plan to meet like starting in September next year, because we have to look at some different options than what we currently have.
And we are. I know Brianna is working with the insurance committee. We are looking at a new model in terms of providing health benefits through a cooperative approach, which has been very beneficial in other parts of the state. I think there's three different cooperatives that exist currently. And if there's a possibility for us to, quote, tag on with one of those. But they have to look at us also from the standpoint of, what is your utilization rate? And that is a little bit of a deterrent right now. So we're hoping as we go through our wellness plans and we work on some of these things, right, that there'll be a point in time when they would look at us and say, we'd be willing to accept you in. That broadens the base, and it gives you a better, what I would call, quote option in the future as well. So.
Right. We're very excited about that. I represent the CESA 3 cooperative, and there are 8 districts in CESA 3 right now, and I'm working with them. I'm actually meeting with them this Thursday. They've already approved to expand into Columbia County, and I that was a big push because I told them how interested Lodi might be to come into the co-op. But now we're looking to expand it to include CESA 4, CESA 5, and CESA 3. And we're really excited about it. I'm getting a lot of momentum. I'm spending my entire summer in CESA 3, 4, and 5 to talk to superintendents and to get the word out, you know, that this is going to be a really big opportunity. I feel like pre-Act 10, we were all kind of clustered together. Most of us were with WEA, and, you know, we were frustrated with our costs. And then after Act 10, everyone, it was an explosion. Everyone could go out on their own. We got some of our own experience. This is great. Well, guess what? All of our costs have continued to go up. We've eroded our plans, and our premium contributions are going up. So now it looks good to band together again. And the nice part about that is in the co-op, you know, obviously the health insurance is number one, but there are opportunities for dental, for life, for disability, for on-site mental health, for sky's the limit. I'm very passionate about this and really excited. So I will be sharing all of that information with the committee when we get back together this fall. And I think we'll have a lot of momentum going into that. And I think that'll be great. But what Chuck said, what's so important is I really hope, knock on wood, I continue to monitor our claims each month. I really hope that we can start improving and that we can move in a good direction, because we've had to take on a lot of high costs. And as a reminder, that is why we have insurance, and, you know, it's really great that we're taking care of our people and they're getting wonderful care. So I always like to say that, you know, when sharing information, that we've not been running well with our claims. That's why you have insurance. But I really hope that moving forward, if maybe we can have this co-op as an option when you join, the law of large numbers, obviously, if we have more people in this co-op, we can spread the risk around, and it will be easier for us to weather the storm than instead of being out on our own. So That's what we're going to take a look at moving forward.
Chuck, is all this unbudgeted numbers, or was there some budget number in here for any?
No, it's all budgeted numbers from the standpoint of it still falls within. If you look at the 1,200 and the 500, which was what we're looking at, that's that $200,000 and $300,000 deficit. That's budgeted into that equation.
I'll make a motion. I'll make a motion to, of course, my computer's restarting now, so I can't make it, to increase. So I'll make a motion to add $1,000 contribution to the district contribution rate for the family and $500 for the individual plan.
Second.
Rick's would prefer discussion.
So that's the middle plan.
I think that makes the most sense.
That's 500, like
500 to the single and then 1,000 to the family. That makes sense.
What's that, 6%?
Yeah, roughly. I had it up. I was doing it. But...
Any other discussion? Okay, we're going to do a roll call. Starting with Stephen.
Yes.
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 Okay, I'm caught up.
That's me. No.
Yep.
No.
Yes. So the motion carries 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to 2. So thank you for coming this evening and explaining to us. And thank you for your continued work with us.
Yes, thank you. I love working with your district. Sorry I got chatty.
All right, next we have the NAMI High School HVAC contract.
Randy Carpenter is here. I contacted Randy today just in case there were questions about this. I'll give you a background on it. We started about a year ago looking at our high school, which has always been kind of an energy...
sucker.
Yeah, there you go. That's a good word. Okay. It just uses a lot of energy in comparison to our other buildings. And it was built in 1997. It was what was called recommissioned in the early 2000s era. But when you recommission a building, it means you take a look at the entire system. What is it doing? What does it need to make it efficiently operate or more efficient, operate more efficiently? But nothing was really done that I can find in order to address some of those concerns. Back in 2008, a group came in. They did the same thing. They went through the building from top to bottom. They recommissioned it, gave a set of recommendations. But at that time, the district in 2008, if you remember the whole circumstances, did not have the funding. So those things got pushed off. And here we are now in 2016, and we're still in the same boat. And I had, we put a service contract in place with the idea that we needed to make sure that this equipment was being maintained, that it was being taken care of. We had cut back on our own personal maintenance staff, so we didn't have the personnel. So they've been servicing and making sure that our belts and filters and all those kinds of things got taken care of over the last couple of years. And then we started looking at the whole energy use situation. And again, we don't have either the expertise or the people internal to our organization. So I went to North America and talked with Randy, talked with Jerry Tinberg, and we talked about what could we do in order to bring this building under a little bit better control. I happened to work in Wanakee. We had a high school similar, doing the same thing, just sucking up a lot of energy. I happened to be the interim superintendent there. I went to NAMI. We went through the same process. And I think I gave each of you kind of a sample of what transpired from the time that I hired them to take over operation of Wanakee High School. I also hired them to monitor, manage the set temperatures, et cetera. They also came up with recommendations relative to what would make the system function more efficiently. And the bar graph kind of gives you that cost factor. On the other side of the equation, I talked with the people there, which happened to be the high school principal, the director of buildings and grounds, And what I can truthfully tell you is that there were places in that building that in the wintertime it might be 55, 56 degrees, and the only way you could make it any better was to turn up the heat, which then across the hallway people are sweltering in 85-degree rooms. They have come in, they've taken that building, they've turned it around, and actually added more square footage to that building with the remodeling, and it's operating more efficiently than our building. So I said, we need to see if we can do the same thing. And that's kind of where we got to the point where we are. Took it to the facility committee. They forwarded a recommendation to contract with them for the $207,000 a year to literally take over that entire building, come in, manage it, make repairs, bring it up to quote what I would call the efficiency operation status that it should be, and then begin to take a look at what can we do in order to reduce energy costs and utilizations over the process of the next 3 years. One of the things that is part of this is to provide to the board quarterly reports, how are we making, what things have been done, what kind of progress are we making, and to start at a baseline and watch over the next 3 years if we can do something that hasn't been able to be accomplished with this building in the last 20 years. And that's kind of the whole purpose behind it. It also frees up some of our people to do other things and focus their attention on maintaining the buildings that we know that are giving us more and more problems as they age. And we're not going to be moving into a facility plan in the next year or so. So they can focus their attention making sure that those things get dealt with while we attack the high school through NAMI. And if you have any other questions, that's kind of the whole purpose and the rationale and reason behind it. And Randy's here to answer any technical questions that you might have about the contract or the service that they would provide. So if you want to come up, Randy. Just, sure. Okay. This is Randy Carpenter from North American Mechanical. And has been working with me, as I said, over the process of the last year. So we've kind of put this idea and this plan together, along with Jerry Tinberg, who's not here tonight. And then John, and I can't remember John's last name.
John Parker.
John, okay. The three of us, four of us, and Tom has been part of this equation off and on as well.
Yeah, Jerry wished he could have been here tonight, but he's also on the utility board for Jefferson, and he had a session tonight also. So,
Randy, thanks for coming. I'll start because I'm the biggest skeptic, so we'll get my questions out of the way.
Sure.
Yes, Chuck's laughing now, but I've been throwing so much at him. I am a skeptic. We've gone through this maintenance program before, mm-hmm. and I guess, does he have a copy of the Wanakee of this handout?
He might not have, but I can give him one.
I don't know if you've seen a copy of that, but Chuck, I assume that is a historical usage. Okay, so for getting the rate, we can't control the rate. We know that. So is the volume, if I'm reading this right, is it total kilowatts or total therms? Which one would be, in other words, which of the two do we have the greatest
usage
ability to impact?
I believe we've discussed it's the therms.
It is the therms. Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so looking at Wanakee, and again, this is the first time I've seen this. So,
yeah.
So it looks like though, if I'm reading this right, that one facility increased its therms. Did they add portions of a building though that would account
yeah.
for that? Or
they actually added another 170 some thousand square feet to a building that was already over 200,000. So it's their building is almost 400,000 square feet from one end to the other.
Okay.
So it's twice the size of ours, basically.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. So how do we, I mean, we've kept stating that we need to obviously do something with the high school because it's definitely not it's not performing. So as I understand it, the contract would be a 3-year contract, right? Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So I'm just going to ask bluntly because I've asked Chuck this. How do we hold your company accountable to see some results? Because we are tired and we don't have money to burn. You've heard already some of the dialogue we've had for the last hour and a half.
Mm-hmm.
How do we work together and how do we get accountability to see see a positive impact? I think there's a lot of frustration with
Well, you know, with everybody on this building, it's not just.
And I agree. I mean, you know, the high school, you know, for the footprint and being a high school and having a pool is a high usage facility. There's no doubt about it. I think everybody pretty much agree on that. What we proposed was, number one, being able to have access and take control of the controls portion of the high school, which involves us in being involved in the scheduling of the facility, daily monitoring. There's things that can happen with equipment, maybe other changes that occur where typically we're going to know before somebody enters the building and expresses a comfort issue, or it's too hot, it's too cold, or whatever. We're going to know that probably before they make an initial complaint.
Mm-hmm.
And that in conjunction, the controls portion of it, and being able to replace equipment, as we outlined in the agreement, in a timely manner without waiting or waiting to, for a complete failure, is definitely going to have some advantages.
How is the monitoring done? Is there like a tactical operations center that monitors all your buildings?
Jerry might refer to it as that. He has both on-site through his computer access and off-site through, again, computer, iPad, whatever, to constantly be monitoring the facility. And typically, he'll be ahead of the schedule. Now, schedules change. I mean, you know, we could set it up for the year, but typically there's some unforeseen event that comes up, and he makes adjustments immediately according to that. But not typically a command center, as you might think, mm-hmm. with multiple screens and so on, but from his computer, he does have direct access to the controls portion.
And who is that going to be? That's
Jerry Tinberg.
And when Jerry is out, who's his backup?
Jerry has, typically we have a gentleman up in Appleton that also handles controls. We also have Mike Gehrman that I don't know if anybody knows, but he's a technical support specialist. And so we're covered.
We also have an on-site person, Kevin, who is a community member, who basically services, monitors, and works with our staff internally on a daily basis or a weekly basis as needed.
Correct.
From the service standpoint. So he understands and knows the system and also has a community connection. So that's another kind of safety factor on my part, is that we have a community member that's going to be involved in this equation.
And Kevin's forever present in the district. And typically, if Jerry noticed something that may be mechanical in nature, we have boots on the ground, so to speak, to check that out and confirm or make the repair.
Okay. So getting back to the accountability portion, because I want to believe that this is going to work. But So what are our goals a year from now when you're back in front of this board and we take a look at the energy consumption for the last year compared to previous years? Do we have any goals on what that looks like in terms of usage? And again, I think we all know rate is not within our realm of impact, but usage we can impact. So what's our goals for the next year?
Putting it in monetary dollar figures would be rather difficult at this point. Now, there is going to be savings, as we outlined in the agreement portion, and I believe the last two documents that were distributed.
Jerry estimated, I think it was $23,000.
Roughly,
The target that he would be shooting for in terms of $23,000 in savings.
Savings. Is that, do you know off the top of your head, is that like a 5% overall usage, or?
I think we estimated roughly 5% to begin with.
Okay. I think that's a tangible goal. Yep.
We believe it's achievable, and of course we've done work with other school districts, similar type buildings. Of course, we've been
invested. The question I have is: but are you still working with equipment that's? That's what the problem is that we got a building that can't do what it needs to do, and so having everybody look at it and kind of watch it over a couple of years, it's still, you're looking at the same crummy equipment is causing the problem, right? We don't have that in the middle school, right? There's not a problem over there. What is the problem?
Well, there's equipment concerns, and of course, a lot of it, you know, is the age of the equipment. But again, you can extend the life through that through ongoing and proper maintenance and repair. And those repairs are somewhat reduced under the new agreement due to the fact that we're just going to take care of it. Now, coils and different things of that nature that develop holes and things, that's a little different ball game. But actuators and motors and things of that are typically your failure points, and those are going to be replaced, again, in a timely manner.
Will that be included in part of the quarterly reports that we get?
That will be.
Okay.
So what's not included?
We gave some typical things that aren't included, and it's things that usually can wear out.
Yeah, you got it. It's right there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It just gave some typical examples. And typically those aren't serviceable items anyway.
Currently, the way that we operate is if something is failing, they will notify us through our service agreement. And then we have to make the decision whether we're going to replace it or not based on our budget, because we're the ones that are footing the bill for it. So a lot of times what will happen, I won't say all the time, but we'll just put it off and say, okay, just let it fail. Then by the time that it's failed, now we're back to the point of it's gone, but that takes a unit out of service while we're getting the parts and then putting it back into place, which means that other components of the system have to work harder to cover for that system that's now down and not being serviced during the process of the time. With the new service agreement, if they recognize something that is in need of replacement or repair, they do it. Maintain the efficiency, the operation of the system, which they have, quote, commissioned, mm-hmm. and hopefully over the process of the next few months, that will occur. So that these things that we've been talking about, I guess multiple different times, that this didn't get fixed, this didn't get fixed, this didn't get fixed, they're going to get fixed. We're going to bring the system up, at least from what we've talked about, to the point that it's operating the way that it's supposed to operate. All cylinders are firing the way they're supposed to. Now we know where we're at in terms of a baseline. If nothing else, for a month, we can monitor to make sure that it's operational. Now we can begin to tweak the things that we want to try to see if we can lower costs. Right now, we've got a system that, for all practical purposes, isn't even operating at 100% efficiency.
Right.
I will tell you that there are fans that aren't running. There are motors that aren't operating. There are AHUs, air handler units, that are not functioning at full capacity. We're servicing them, but the responsibility to make those repairs and to make those changes fall in our lap. And we haven't got the funds in order to say, let's commit to this, because we've got boilers at the middle school, or we got, you know, something else going on in another building, and those funds get appropriated. So we keep limping along, and if you don't have the system fixed at some point in time, how can we ever determine whether we can make it more efficient or not?
So if we make these savings, we're like looking at, compared to the current program, it's like around $16,000 or $17,000 more. If, let's say, we get the $14,000 savings.
Yep.
Is that, am I?
Well, it's $30,000 more just for the plan. If we get the $14,000 savings,
right,
then, you know, we're basically buying a $25,000 insurance program policy.
Well, and then other costs that we have had to expend during the process of the year, which, I, you know, I wish I could go back and tell you exactly how many hours my staff have spent up there, but they haven't been recording what they're supposed to. So I've estimated somewhere between $15,000 and $25,000 that we have spent of our own time, our own funds, in order to make repairs in that building this year.
So you think this will be about a wash, probably?
I can't see where this isn't going to be something that's going to be beneficial long-term, because I've seen it work before. If I'm wrong, then I'll swallow the crow that comes with it, and we'll all be in the same boat.
So,
but it's doing something rather than doing the same thing over and over and over again and having the same conversation, but never really solving the problem, which is why is that building so darn expensive to operate?
Yeah, so the facility committee did forward the proposal with the recommendation. I'm going to vote for it, but from my personal opinion is that I want this year to be the year we figure out what's wrong.
Yep.
I'm tired of it, and I think the district is tired of it, and the employees are tired of it. So we may not fix it a year from now, but we're going to know what we need to do, what needs to be replaced to fix it, because I don't have it in front of me, but I know Tom gave the, it was the cost per, what was the cost per square foot? What was it? It was it was supposed to be 1.2, and it's up to like what, 1.6, 1.7? It's ridiculous.
It ranges between 1.58 and 1.68, and we should be operating at 120 to 130 range. Okay.
So that's what we got to figure out, and that's what I want to know.
Well, and as you probably know, we're very familiar with the high school, very familiar with the equipment that's in the high school, and of course responsible for the installation of the controls and knows how those should work and work properly. And we're confident we can turn the corner here. We've done it in the past, again, with other districts and other very similar facilities. The quarterly reports are one thing that we've noted time and time in our correspondence that we are more than willing to provide,
right?
More frequent if needed.
Right. And those quarterly reports were the committee's idea, and that is those are to come to this full board so that every member is
sure.
able to.
Yep. Yep. Yes.
Again, we don't want this just to we also want to set up your company for success too. We
right.
want to. You know, be in the know, and you know, just so that you know, we just don't sign the contract, and then we're sitting here a year talking about what went right and what went wrong. We
no, it has to be sooner. I totally agree, and we need to track it and have the accountability in place to do so.
Okay, so something is wrong with the system. Our custodians do not have to go up there and figure everything out. Correct? You are the ones who get called.
That is correct.
You come over. You take care of it, because they were up there a lot. Had nothing to do with you, but
right.
they were up there a lot. They called all the time, getting calls all the time. I worked there for 30 years, so it's freezing in this room. It's cold. It's really cold in this room. It's not as bad as when we had the portables, and there was mushrooms growing on the inside, though. Mm-hmm. I will say that.
So Mark's decided he's going to vote for it, so I'm going to capitalize on that.
Wow.
And I will make a motion that we approve the proposal as the Facilities Committee
Jeez.
Has proposed it.
You know what? He's the new finance chair. I can't do that. I will second.
Oh.
Whoa.
Wow.
Yeah. But Shelley brought up a great point, and I think it's important, though. What is the staff escalation process look like? And what is the administration, you know, communication? Is it Chuck directly to you, or is it a Tom? Does the staff go to you? Is there a ticket
Tom
system?
And I
How
are
does
the,
that work?
We're the ones that will be discussing the reports and getting the information to you. As far as on-site, Kevin, who is the gentleman that I mentioned before, Linda, who is in that building, the fielding of complaints, et cetera, will follow the same process as it has before. It's just that we'll notify Jerry. Or he may know it already and just notify us that I've noticed that, you know, there's a problem in the H wing. We're working on it. I'll have someone up there with boots on the ground at 6:30 this morning to see if we can get this rectified before kids get there. Tracy will be working directly with Jerry from the standpoint of the facility management, what things are going on in that building, so he can use your policy relative to set points to start up and take down the temperatures in the building based on what's going on in that building, not just the overall building, but portions of the building. If nothing's going on the second floor, but we got a basketball game, that set point for that second floor is going to go down as soon as, quote, school is over.
Correct.
Which is a savings. Right now, that's where we're losing some of this ability, but we also have a system that isn't totally functioning either, so it's hard to control something that doesn't work the way it's supposed to.
Okay. I think it just really needs to be off the custodians, is my viewpoint of it. So.
Well, and we targeted that as a savings.
Yeah.
in their time being allocated elsewhere for other duties. What Chuck was talking about, we've discussed in length, is the second phase, should this be approved, and because we began on or before July 1st, was exactly laying out a plan of who's involved and what degree and where, how communications flow and so on and so forth. We're permissible. We've also engaged the students in energy education, conservation, and so on down the line. I know in Wanakee they have a group of students that's very diligent in making sure lights are off when they leave the room and things. All these little things come into play and help greatly.
And just even a staff, from the standpoint of doing an energy plan with the staff so that they know that they play a part in all of this, is that you just don't walk and out and leave your room, you know, with the lights on. If you're going out, shut it off. If you shut the door, I mean.
Does that show up in your controls? Can you see that? All which rooms have lights on?
We can't see that.
You can't?
No.
Okay.
No.
I know a system that will do that. Not going there.
Is it an Epic system?
Yeah. All right, there's a motion.
Yep. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0.
Thank you
for coming this evening and
Thank
answering questions.
For Looking forward to doing the job for you.
Great.
So are we.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have the environmental control contract.
This came through the facility committee also from the standpoint of looking forward with our contracted services. Back to the same point is that we looked at what the cost savings were for the district relative to having our own employees providing a service plus versus what we have saved over the process of the last 3 years of the contract being in place. The contractor came back and indicated that their costs had gone up like everybody else, and the committee said to look into a one-year contract with a possible second-year extension. So what the environmental control has offered to us is a 2% per year increase to go enter into a 2-year contract. We have sat down with the company. Part of what Tiffany was talking about earlier is we have a lot of part-time employees, so they cycle through. We tend to find that that's where we get most of our complaints, is when an employee who's been there for a while and kind of got things down leaves and then a new one comes on. We tend to find complaints, but we're working on a communication plan and a coordination plan, similar to what Randy was talking about, to try to rectify those and deal with them a little bit better as we go into next year. But that's the plan that was proposed back to us, is that 2-year, 2% per year, and I think I gave you a sheet that outlined both what we're paying this year as well as what the new contract amounts would be.
We have not given them, I don't think we've had an increase since three years, have we?
No, it's been 3 years of a no increase contract, so this would be the first year of an increase.
So again, this was also proposed by the, or I should say forwarded to the full board for with a recommendation, and since I've been on the facility committee, and I think prior to that, issues with communication, with roles and responsibilities, comes up pretty often. So we will continue to work with the administration, as I know they put a lot of work into it too. So and not just from a cost perspective, does it make it challenging to go back to our old way, but also from a management aspect too. You'd have all the hiring, and it's difficult. So I will make the motion to approve a continuing, I will make a motion to approve a continuing 2-year contract with environmental control for district custodial cleaning services with first contract cost increase not to exceed 2% for the 16-17 contract year, and second year contract cost not to exceed an additional 2% for the 17-18 contract year.
Second.
Seidler, Whipperforth, any discussion?
I still have a problem with EC. I don't think they're the company to be with. I think that with proper management, we could probably pull it off ourselves. I know that the administration is looking into the cost, but there's got to be a way that we can bring more local people in be in our schools instead of bringing in another company like this.
I'm with you on that.
Well, can't the local people choose to
be employees of EC and then work
yes.
here?
Yes.
I don't know.
Yes. When you're paying a company so much money per, they have to split that cost, that money up, so they make money off every employee. The EC company is making money, and the employee that they hire is making an amount of money. I am having trouble figuring out how the EC portion of this, of the money we're paying them, couldn't go to employees to get employees locally and be managed locally.
Well, there's two factors here. One is the employees, that's one factor. But the other cost is all of the cleaning supplies, all the equipment. We would have to be buying those, which right now there's about $60,000 worth of both cleaning supplies and equipment that is furnished by EC to the district in order to carry out cleaning services on a daily basis. If we went back to what you're proposing, and I'm not, you know, pointing at you directly, but if we were to go back to what we had before, we would have to then expend another $60,000 in order to buy equipment and or supplies in addition to, quote, the employees and an hourly and or benefit component. So, you know, that's kind of that behind-the-scenes cost that we no longer have that we had before, which is in addition to what just the labor costs are, just so that everybody's aware of that particular side of the equation.
And the management costs.
And management costs that come with that.
I think that's probably a greater, because I've never been a fan of outsourcing to begin with, but sometimes it just makes sense. And don't forget the difference between us and bringing it in-house, not just about the time, but it's also, what was it, two and a half FTE of an educator. So it is incremental. It is significant. But we will continue to go ahead, and I think this comes up on our agenda probably once a quarter, doesn't it, in terms of this contract, in terms of just managing those relationships and making sure that is, and there's been a lot of positive ground that's been covered. I think most of the buildings are doing pretty well, except for one that
correct.
We know of where there's been some turnover, and we continue to work with this leadership in order to make sure that our needs are met.
And I do know, I can't give you an exact number, but I am aware, personally aware, of five community members that work for EC and work in our buildings. So they are local people working through EC in order to do cleaning services. And I will tell you that part of what we have there is in those buildings where at least three of those individuals work, those buildings tend to have fewer complaints also. So there is that side that Carl is talking about, is that local people, even though they're working even for a contracted service, have that ability to, you know, put more into it, or maybe be take more ownership of that building and the cleaning services that they provide. But I can't, you know, just like with our EAs, they don't get a full-time job out of this. In some cases, they've increased wages and even provided benefits, but they still have the same thing that we have in those kinds of roles, turnover. And that's where we tend to see our problems. Overall, I would say that we're much better today than where we were 3 years ago. But as Mark says, we need to keep working and keep communicating and making sure that, you know, we continue to try to improve the service as best we can. It doesn't mean that even when we had our own employees that we didn't have complaints, because we did. It's just that now it's a cost factor, and if we want to continue to offer educational programs, we have to find savings, and this is one of the areas that we went to in order to try to accommodate it. We still have to try to do the best job we can to make sure our buildings are clean, however.
So doesn't EC should have some full-time employees?
They do.
So then I'm not getting what you're mentioning about...
Because most of the cleaning positions are not necessarily full-time, not all of them, okay?
Okay.
So a lot of people come in after a regular job, and they'll clean for 3 or 4 hours or beyond, you know, for a 4-hour shift because they're looking for extra income. so they're not full-time employees.
Okay, that at least makes sense. I was like, wait, got to have some.
We need to find a way to include them in Lodi Pride.
Okay, the motion is Seidler, Whipperforth. All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
No.
Okay, so we have motion carries 5-2. Thank you.
I need to ask one more question. Okay, so the main deal that we're getting out of EC is that they're doing the managing of it and they're doing the supplies.
They're employees, so they do all of the payroll, they do all of the management, they do all of the purchasing of supplies. If a piece of equipment fails, they purchase it. We have no connection to it other than monitoring the cleaning in our building, saying we need to do a better job in the middle school, or we need to do a better job in the high school, we need to do a better job, or this person isn't doing the cleaning the way that we would like in H-Wing. And that's our responsibility to make sure that that's communicated.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, next agenda item is the Sauk Prairie Healthcare Survey request.
Thank you, Ms. Twin. Co-curricular.
Oh, wait, sorry. Co-curricular proposal review, PBIS and Link Crew.
Yep. This is part of the overall budgeting for staffing, et cetera. This is just going into our co-curricular. This would be offset in terms of the cost of these positions by taking money out of the board budget, $5,300. And $5,500 out of my expense budget, which I just don't turn expenses into the district. And that would offset the cost of this, plus offset the cost of portion of moving the base that we made the motion on earlier. So the Link Crew is an integral part of making sure that kids transition from the middle school to the high school and they're successful providing support and help. PBIS is a position that we started about 3 years ago. They are in each building. People have volunteered their time. They have helped cut down, I guess what I would say is cut down on referrals. They've solidified and codified expectations in the hallways, in classrooms, across the buildings, and they've done it by just offering their time because they felt that it was important. And this was an opportunity to bring it forward, put it into the co-curricular schedule, pay for it from the standpoint of transferring resources from two particular areas in order to cover the cost of it. So
what would be the expected hours that the PBIS or the other ones would work?
Tiffany and Vince, who is probably, both of them have access to both of these.
Number of hours, that's kind of a tricky one. We meet, the actual PBIS committee, the leadership meets sometimes after school and sometimes during professional development, depending on what is scheduled for that professional development day. But then they also do things outside, like creating the agendas. We've done some surveys related to like buy-in of staff and what things they think need to be addressed, so they set up those surveys. At Vince's building, they've done a lot with videos and putting together videos about electronic communication devices and dress code, and so all the time and energy that went into creating those videos as well. So I don't know that I can put like a number of hours on it. That would be a little tricky, but it's
kind of like looking at our homecoming advisors or our senior class advisors. There's just certain times of the year they spend a little more time and certain times they don't. Link Crew, the other one as well, is they will have a 3-day training or a couple training with kids before school even starts. So this summer they will take the students who qualified to be Link leaders, the juniors, seniors, before school starts, they will do training with them. They will facilitate that first day of freshman orientation day. That whole morning they will take, and they will run that with our juniors and seniors facilitating. And then throughout the year, those juniors and seniors will meet once a month with the Link leaders, or the staff who are running it. And then also once a month, then those Link leaders will meet with the freshmen, their freshman group. So coordinating all that, plus some other events like a homecoming tailgate or a tailgate for a football game, an event before finals like a cocoa and cram, where you bring the freshmen in and teach them how to study for finals and give them cocoa and some food. And do some fun stuff like that. So
Okay, I just wondered because it makes sense, but it's nice to give a parallel. So when you think about it as homecoming activity or other things like that, that makes more sense
to me. Yeah, I think that's how in the recommendation I put, I kind of linked it, how I related to different things in the co-curricular contact. That's how we came up with those numbers. And I think I used senior class advisor and homecoming advisor as a two that just kind of linked a little bit or similar.
So is the main person's name Art?
Linkletter?
Yes.
Linkleader, not Linkletter.
Thank you.
Wow. You're welcome.
I'll make a motion to approve adding the PBIS compensation for up to two board-approved PBIS coaches at each district building and link crew compensation for up to two board-approved link crew staff as part of the revised 2016-17 employee handbook co-curricular compensation schedule.
I'll second.
Rick's pair, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries 7-0. Next, we have Sauk Prairie Healthcare Survey request.
When they first contacted me about this, I sent them the policy from the Board of Education regarding research. They went back and met all of the criteria and have fulfilled all of the obligations relative to being approved to conduct this survey. So I think the information that we will obtain will be both beneficial to our staff, coaching and otherwise, as well as providing better services to our kids. So I would administratively recommend approving it because they've met all the criteria of your policy.
Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the Sauk Prairie Healthcare Survey request.
I second that.
Westfall Beers, discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next, we have Code of Conduct Handbook change and insurance waiver.
It's kind of spelled out in terms of the changes that they're recommending. This came through an administrative discussion and with the coaches, essentially to meet a need. Okay.
Yeah, you don't need all the red stuff is good.
Yep. The red stuff is good.
So do we need a motion on this? Yep. It's already approved.
So wait, but I'm not... It's now just a student? It's not the parent signs anymore? Is it? What's the difference?
Vince, you have...
There's no place for the parent on here. Print student name, student signature.
The student code of conduct.
Student activities code of conduct.
Wasn't this approved?
The student parent agreement. And
I don't know what you're looking at. Sorry.
So it says it's a student parent agreement, but the parent doesn't agree to anything.
Yeah, there's no place for the parent to sign.
I don't know where this came from.
It's usually the student that doesn't agree with it.
I don't know my parents sign.
Said it's the last page of the code.
Yeah, it's just...
Okay.
Insurance waiver is another item.
I'm going to plead that I've been gone for 6 weeks. And was not a part of this, so I don't know where this came from.
Very good call.
Or why that was waived.
But when does it need to go into effect? Not until the fall? So bring it back.
I said deleting the parent signature also.
I make a motion that we just table this until next time and you guys can...
I'll second it. I'll third it.
The concern I have is, is there going to be enough time to make adjustments and still get it to the printer?
If it's the code of conduct, we print that in ourselves. That one we take care of. You're thinking of the student handbook.
Yes.
That's already been sent.
Okay.
It's done.
So don't you have code meetings meeting already?
They've already had some code meetings, yep. Yeah. Because they would have had, like, for example, football already had their meeting. I believe soccer had their meeting.
So do we have a code of conduct committee?
Tom Dorgan in connection with the athletic directors and a group of students forwarded this to me. I just assumed that the conversation had taken place and there was a reason for doing this. I did not, for all practical purposes, understand or see that the parents don't sign it, so I'm not sure exactly why that would be taken off, because that's part of what we need, is to make sure that
they... you want to see the last page? Mo, can you click on that, please?
Mm-hmm. Sorry, Mo, can you click on it again?
Yeah, she's got the controls.
There's the waiver that was going to be also approved, and this is the one that's the section being taken out.
Very bottom.
Yeah, I see that.
Page replaced the first
one. And then this is what's going to be there.
So that's going to replace it, or no? Is that what you said?
That's the waiver that they have to sign.
I'm fine with it being tabled. I think we just need to find out.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything that's going to happen between now and the July board meeting that
necessitates
us having this.
Okay.
So I we can table it.
Okay, thank you. So we got Beer Seidler saying to table this. All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next, we have the primary school OSC, elementary school, and middle school parent-student handbooks.
Didn't we already approve these?
No.
For next year.
Last year.
I did high school already.
We're moving forward.
Okay. I'll make a motion to approve the primary school OSC, elementary school, middle school parent-student handbook as presented.
I'll second.
Seidler, Westfall, discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next, we have the primary school OSC, elementary school, middle school faculty handbooks.
I'll make a motion that we approve primary school OSC, elementary school, middle school facilities faculty handbook.
I'll second.
Westfall, Ricks, discussion?
Just one question. Where did this one come from, a committee?
I'll have to ask Sherry and
just the
faculty handbook.
Yeah, the faculty.
That's done every year.
It's done every year. We just make changes yearly.
Okay.
Does that have a question
about it? I don't think so. No, I was just curious where. That's all. Thank you.
Okay, so we have a motion, Westfall, Ricks. All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next, we have T&G banner proposal.
Yeah, originally this was proposed on the basis that we have 20 banners on the Highway 60 outfield fence. Originally, the facility committee thought that there was a policy or a procedure that limited it to 20. I went back and looked at all of the documentation we have, and there's really not a limit. It just it has to come through in a formal approval process. So T&G, which is a company in town, asked if they could buy a banner to go on the outfield fence because there's two extra spots on each end. The facility committee reviewed it, approved it in terms of coming forward, providing the facility committee would make a change in the policy. Well, there's no need to make a change in the policy. It's just approving this so that T&G can have their banner made and we install it on the fence. If another company comes forward, we have room for one more, but then that's as many as we could have unless somebody decides not to renew for the coming year.
I'll make a motion that we approve the addition of
two
banners.
Second.
Ricks, Wepperfirth, discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Motion, opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Next item, there are not any new first read policies this evening. We have one policy second reading, the custodial.
And I would ask that we table any action on this. Originally, this was to be presented at the policy committee along with job descriptions because that's where it was coming through. We didn't have a policy committee meeting, so nobody got a chance to review it, but we have a contract review, so I just move the job descriptions and this evaluation over to the contract review, which is meeting on Thursday, so I'll bring it back in July. No harm done, but I want at least a committee to review it before we actually bring it to the full board. So if there's anything that they feel need to be modified or changed, we can make those changes before it is reviewed here.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do we need to have a motion to table it?
Yes.
I will make that motion.
Second.
Seidler, Whipperforth, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Under gifts and donations, there are not any this evening. Administrative reports, high school. Mr. Briney.
Well, hello.
Hi.
I've been gone for a while, so I don't have anything to report this evening. No, I included quite a few things in my report. The first was FFA news, just that we had Michaela Endres competing in the dairy handler portion of the Wisconsin FFA career development event. She won at the state level and will compete at the national FFA level this fall.
Awesome.
And our egg sales career development team also won the state contest and advanced to the National FFA Convention. And as far as Ms. Crook had shared it, that had never happened either of those since she's been here. So credit and accomplishment for Michaela. And then for the ag sales team, it was Joy and Haley Hillenbrand, Austin Meinholz, and Sam Jesse. So an accomplishment. Congratulations to them. Wanted to thank all the board members who participated in graduation ceremony. It was Mr. Purcell ordered great weather again, so we had a great ceremony outside, which we always like. I also mentioned that in their report that Lodi has once again been named an advanced placement pace setter school. So we've been recognized by the Wisconsin Advanced Placement Advisory Council. This recognition is actually for the 2014-15 school year, based on the percent of our student population who takes an advanced placement test and how well they do. So. We also were named to the AP District Honor Roll this past fall as well, so it's the third year in a row for both of those honors for the Lodi School Districts, which is great. And obviously the town is still buzzing a little bit about our athletic season that we've kind of finished here at the end. We had 15 athletes go to the state track and field and participate and did a great job, and I shared some of the results with you in the report. Our golf team made it state as well and finished third overall, just outside of a trophy. But Jacob Michael finished second overall in Division II. He had one of his worst days of golf ever the first day and came back with a phenomenal day of golf, had the best round of the tournament.
Did he get rid of 20 strokes almost?
Yeah, 60. He shot an 83, I think, the first day, and a 67 second day.
Awesome.
And just as impressive, if not more impressive, our team, I just got an email today that our golf team was named honorable mention D2 Academic All-State.
Ooh.
As a team. So congratulations not only to them, how they do it in the golf course, but how they're doing it in the classroom as well, which is really difficult because our golf kids miss a lot of school. And it takes a lot of work outside to make sure that they're doing what they need to do. And finally, our baseball team won the sectional final over Whitewater a week ago. And they will play Milwaukee Lutheran Wednesday night at 6 p.m. in Appleton for a chance to play in the state title game. And if they win, they would play on Thursday at 3 o'clock and hope for good weather. Last time we went to state baseball, it was a late night because of rain delays and things like that. So, again, the teams have represented us very well, not only how they participate on the field, but how they conduct themselves off the field and in the stands and things like that. So congratulations to the Blue Devils.
Thank you.
Questions? Thank you.
Curriculum.
All right. Well, we wrapped up at the end of the year our curriculum goals for this year, and we are really focused on documenting our curriculum, and so we had teachers in each department do a curriculum map, and part of their checkout procedures was to share that electronically with us so we can document that progress. And then today and tomorrow, we are doing our administrative retreat. So we're looking at what are the next steps in terms of curriculum and what do we want them to have documented next. So planning for next year. Also looking at professional development planning for next year. And then educator effectiveness, trying to make our educator effectiveness and evaluation system a little more efficient. And then also discussion of implementation of academic and career planning, which is a new mandate for next year for us to implement more of a focus on careers across K-12. We're also waiting on assessment data from our spring test, which we won't get back until late in July. We have some trainings coming up already this Wednesday. We're doing a training on trauma-sensitive classrooms, so it's about working with kids that have withstood a level, differing levels of trauma in their life. And then also I'm working on DPI reports and wrapping up special education paperwork that are stacked up over there. So.
I have a question, comment, yeah. Statement. I don't know where it is. I have a lot of concerns about our STEM, particularly our technology and engineering section. Mm-hmm. And I'm already on three committees, so I can't really be on a fourth of curriculum. But are we working towards changes in that area?
That's one thing we were just discussing today at our administrative retreat in terms of, you know, how do we want to move forward. And we talked about it kind of being part of our discussion related to our whole curriculum effort in terms of, you know, some revamp of curricular areas and also academic and career planning, because we can't really expose kids to those engineering and more scientific fields if we don't have programs that they can feed into in our school district. So we just had kind of the initial conversation today about how we can do that in terms of, are we going to put a committee together? How do we, what are our next steps going to be, and how can we involve people in the community? And
So this is not something that will be resolved by the next school year then?
No. It's a big...
It's big.
It's really big. It involves a lot of different career and technical education areas, and then also science, obviously, and looking at not only how does this just impact our 6-12, but then really we have to expose kids to some of these engineering concepts in kindergarten through fifth grade. Otherwise, they're not going to have that interest in it by the time they get to middle school and high school.
Even if we get something started in the high school, it's something above a senior citizen woodshop class, I think would go a long way.
Yeah,
I agree that the whole program needs to get there.
Right.
But again, the thing that I seem to be preaching every month is that we don't know the sparks that we're missing with these kids, and there are kids that would latch on to welding, machining, all these things that we're losing right now.
I think part of the problem, and having been a former member of the curriculum committee, is all of the requisites are pretty substantial, so there's only so many hours in there.
For
a third and fourth grader.
I think one of the next step things that we could really do is we have identified at the end of this last year some districts that we could visit, even if it just means, like you said, adding one class, adding two classes at the middle school, high school level, that's a place to start as we look at the big picture and how does this impact us across K-12. That was something that we came up with last year, that not only our tech ed people, but other maybe science people could also.
Is it also, though, a resource issue? Because that's an issue for us if it is. Is it? I don't know.
It's really just about changing. I mean, it's a variety of different things, I would guess. Yeah, resources in terms of, you know, as we talk about facilities, if we talk about facilities down the road, STEM programming and how that interacts with what type of facilities we need is important, but it's also just changing. You know, when I look at, I just recently, and watching my son get registered or pick his classes for next year, was looking through the Monona Grove catalog, and they kind of have two tracks in career in tech ed. So my son loves tech ed, so he loves more of the trades part of tech ed, but there's a whole line of engineering courses that they can take as well. So there's a lot of different video production, and, you know, there's just a lot of different options. But
I get all of that, and yeah. I love all the discussions that are happening around that, and even the discussions within the facilities about building facilities for that. Mm-hmm. And I think that's great. We have classes now,
mm-hmm.
that could be raised up to the next level, and that's something that I think could happen by the next year.
Yeah, I agree.
And I think we're missing opportunities with kids. We're missing kids that aren't necessarily, you know, on the advanced placement track or aren't necessarily science wizards, but might love building something with their hands or learning a trade. And I think that's an area where, if Lodi has a deficiency, I think that's where we have one right now. And so I'd like to see something done, and I know I'm not on the committee, and I trust you guys are going to do it. You guys are going to do it. But I just wanted some place to voice my concern about mm-hmm. this, and I didn't know where else to do it. So
I've always felt for years we're missing the middle kids. We have stuff for the AP kids. We have stuff for the kids that need help on the other end, but the kids in the middle, the B and C and D students, I think, I felt for years we're missing those kids. We can't always find something that they can get locked into.
I don't disagree, but like I think like Tiffany and Bill said, it's big. And if it is, if it's something that I think if we want to prioritize, we should make it part of our district-wide goals. We have those set of goals that are out there.
That's, I'm all for
it's
it.
4K all the way through 12. It's not just.
I get that. No, I definitely get that, and I want to see a degree of good implementation. But I also.
But it can't just be Tiffany, go figure it out.
No. I don't. I'm not saying
right,
that either.
Why not?
She does everything. No, I think it's as simple as looking at the curriculum that's offered there now and saying, how are we executing that curriculum?
How can we up the ante?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's
write that down, too.
All right, I got it for our next agenda.
Thank you.
Don't make me come to that committee meeting.
Okay.
I'll be quick here. So some really good news on our front, and it's not that good news. We haven't gotten word back on the grant yet, but Paula has been appointed by the governor to the state AODA advisory board.
Nice.
She has a two-year term on there, so she'll be directly affecting the AODA processes and procedures that come down for that. So that is... I think they finally have somebody on there that knows what they're doing. LCAT will be partnering with the Lodi Police Department and the Lodi Library this summer, and we're offering 3 family game nights in the community. So we're doing this instead of the movie nights. The movie nights got to be extremely expensive by the time we paid all the licensing fees, and it depended on, you know, if it was a good movie, you had to pay a lot more. So this is our substitute. This is going to connect the police department with the community more, and I think it's going to be a great thing. We had a very good meeting with the Lodi Pride committee, and actually in your packets there is a timeline that we kind of put out that is a suggested timeline of all the things we want to do, and actually that's probably only about 50% of what we wanted to do, but we figured we had to start small. We're going to be working a lot more closely with community organizations, other community organizations, and even businesses to try to get, you know, Lodi Pride menu items like the Lodi Pride burger, or, you know, just try to get Lodi Pride everywhere, all the way up to getting a billboard on an interstate that says Lodi Pride with a big arrow pointing towards Lodi or something of that effect. So we're going to take that to the next level. And then, of course, my standard reminder of National Night Out is August 2nd. It's going to be big. We're going to have MedFlight landing. They're actually going to have fire trucks and ambulances actually doing stuff and showing people things. And then we're having a record number of organizations in the community that offer things for youth and parents to do. We'll be there as well. And the block party wagon is going like crazy. I pretty much spend all weekend long moving that darn thing around. I'm not sure whose idea it was to do that, but yeah. But we're getting a lot of uses out of it. We've already done 12 events, and we've still have many, many more booked, and they're coming in. I think 3 came in today, so it's great.
And it doesn't cost anything to use the wagon, correct?
No.
But donations are accepted.
Donations should be encouraged.
We leave that to them, but. No, it's free, and we even provide the propane for the grill, and we even replace the grill tools when they get burned up. So
I wasn't there, so
it seems to be about every weekend.
I have a question. I don't know if it's something you can answer. If not, but the shop on the corner, they put a sign out. Steve, is
this not a head shop?
Yeah, is there? I don't know. Is that an ordinance that the city can enforce in terms of what the phrases on those signs? Do you know? You probably don't, but I don't know.
I don't know. I know. I think he's following the ordinances as they are because they cannot be permanent signs, and so he's got a temporary sign.
But in terms of what it can say,
I would just like to say what would cause you to have to put that on a sign?
And it's obviously it's slang that, yeah, it just puts it out there. And
it,
I know.
It seems like a bad business move to me, but.
Yeah. Okay. I was just curious. That's all. Thanks.
Okay, Lodi Primary School.
I'd like to recognize Linda Dome for 24 years of service as an educational assistant. She has done an amazing job over the years, listening to students read, giving out assessments, assisting with centers, supervising the playground and the lunchroom, and of course being crossing guard extraordinaire in the morning and in the afternoon. She's been dependable, caring. Every day I witness students running over and hugging her as she's leaving to get in her car with her crossing sign. Bye, Mrs. Dome. Bye, Mrs. Dome. Nobody cares that I'm out there getting kids in cars, but they all want to appreciate her. She was able to get the kids to believe in themselves and do the best that they can do. We're going to miss her after 24 years. I would also like to recognize Megan Bowig. She worked with OSC for the last 4 years. She analyzed their data, planned interventions, and worked with students weekly to increase their reading and math skills. She's moving on to other opportunities in her life. Fifth grade students went on a plant dig to dig perennial flowers to sell. This is one of their fundraisers. They made approximately $1,000 in profits. They brought all of them back in boxes and bags on a school bus and took their time to clean out the bus when they got back. I'd like to thank the five middle school students, Morgan McNeil, Lily Griffin, Madison O'Mara, Matthew Brisky, and Noemi Alcantara, and the adult Jesse Lane, who came over to help on the Lodi Day of Pride. They helped Rick Brisky on the back hill clean out bushes and pull weeds and take care of that and make the hill look nice as you drive by on the street. 4K hosted a family picnic on the playground on May 26th, and once again we had great weather. The adults were all ready to leave at 7, but the 4-year-olds were not. So when I left, there was only like 10 people left, but it was getting to be 7:30, so I thought they were on their own. OSC graduation, they had fifth grade graduation in the PAC on June 2nd, and again, it was a very emotional night with the students letting the advisors know what an impact they had on their lives. Lots of tears on the adults' and the students' faces. Kindergarten had their graduation ceremony at the PAC on June 3rd. It's amazing, again, what Mrs. Weber can get out of five-year-olds. They were very polished and professional, and all the students had a chance to hug Mrs. Dome on their way off of the stage. OSC's service project at the end of the year was to organize field day for the kindergarten and 4K students. There was a bounce house, petting zoo, water games, and other fun activities, and the students organized it all. The fifth graders did all the organizing, drew maps. The third and fourth graders worked in groups and took groups of students around from station to station. Mrs. Brickle had a 4K graduation. It was just a short program for her morning and afternoon classes, and of course, lots of tears again. OSC end of the year field trip was to Smoky Hollow on June 3rd. And here's a list of 50 families that donated to the OSC musical for their big fundraiser each year. Any questions? Right, thank you.
Thank you. Elementary school.
I'm going to let Joe go.
Thank
you. Mr. Prosit. I am totally surprised that a video is coming.
I think we heard it a little bit.
Yeah. He's
over there editing right now.
Attention for that.
We'll let him do his dog and pony show after this. We held our fifth to sixth grade transition May 27th. All incoming sixth graders came over and spent the afternoon at the middle school, ate lunch, got tours, got to ask questions, and just help reduce the anxiety of them moving up to the middle school. On May 31st, we had our sneak a peek night, and that's an opportunity for the students to come with their parents. We had students giving tours to everybody, the infamous opening of the locks, asking questions, just meeting people. We really had a good turnout for a busy night at the end of May. I want to thank the students who gave tours and the sixth grade team for all their work in organizing that. I want to give a shout out to our seventh and eighth grade math team. They finished first in our region and went to state. And competed very well there, quite an accomplishment. The students that were part of that team, Blaze Zander, Zach Potter, Ben Simplot, Brandon Grover, Emma Vanderkoy, Anna Avila, Zulon Ness, and Krista Mayberry. So quite an honor. This was mentioned earlier, but really want to thank Lucinda Ranney for all of her work for the 8th grade day of service. I know a number of you were out and about helping but it's really a neat opportunity to see those kids out and volunteering their time and really making a difference in the community. I was fortunate enough to visit a number of sites and to see the good work that they were doing. It was very impressive. On June 3rd, we held our first Unity Day. I've kind of been sharing updates with you all year. That's kind of been our focus. Different Unity, meaning 6 through 8 activities. I really want to highlight, and Chuck mentioned this at the end of the year, but that Senior March, we incorporated that into this day, and I want to thank Renee Potter for coming up with the idea. But it was very well received at the middle school, and I don't want to say I was skeptical because I wasn't, but sometimes you don't know how things will exactly go. But it was, I saw tears from the seniors coming out. I mean, it was a neat event for everybody. So hopefully that is a tradition that continues. And we held our 8th grade recognition on June 7th. Went very well. Some handed out some awards, had about an hour-long ceremony. And I want to recognize these students: Kelly Bestel, Samantha Morey, Elizabeth Tenbarge, Henry Jesse, Emily Alcantara, Dalton Patterson, Emma Heller, and Colin Stott. They were part of an organizing committee that organized all the festivities for after the farewell ceremony. So we had a dance and there was food and just a really neat night on their second to last day of school. And the tech committee, we haven't met, but you saw the progress of our work earlier tonight.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. Elementary school.
So our second graders went to Elder Leopold, and Sharon Whipperfirth, second grade teacher, put together this thank you video to send to the Elder Leopold Center. So I just thought I'd share this with you. So thank you, Sharon Whipperfirth, for putting this together. We are so fortunate to live in Lodi and be so close to so many wonderful opportunities. The third graders went to the Crane Foundation, and they studied their crane. They picked out a crane to study, and then they made a life-size crane before they went up. And the people at the Crane Foundation were so impressed with when they got to the crane that they were studying, and they saw the crane, and they knew so much about it. They were like, oh my goodness, they actually know something about the crane before they got here, and then they could ask better questions to the people. So it was pretty amazing, that trip as well. I would just like to thank the food service for their cookouts each year. They do a great job of that, and Greg Sharpie's always there to cook out the hamburgers and hot dogs, so thank you to them, and thank you to Kelly Rear and Tom Knack for helping set up the tables outside. It's a great event that the schools host in every building, and it's a lot of work for the custodians, the food service workers, and it's very much appreciated by our staff and the students. I'd like to thank Al and Angie Trinan and all the volunteers for the 8th grade day of service at the Trinan Farm for our Pioneer Day, 4th grade Pioneer Day. This is another great place to have our Pioneer Day, and it was so amazing to see those 8th graders take over those stations and really lead those and do such a great job. And thank you, Mr. Purcell and Ms. Loken, for coming out to the farm as well and showing the kids your support. Thank you to Nancy Ravensdorf for teaching our kids how to square dance so then when they got back to school, they could square dance and finish their day off. And thank you to Joan Gerke and Sheila Van Lankveld for always making that homemade ice cream that they enjoy with a scoop of ice cream on top of their apple pie. So thank you for that as well. And thank you to Mrs. Carter, Mrs. Sager, and Mrs. Schmeling for their extra work. And it all comes together, and the many parent volunteers as well. So thank you. Our field day was a huge success. Thank you to Beth Lang. She does most of the organizing of all of those stations. Thank you to the people that came in. Mr. Ricks, thanks for coming and helping on that day. Lots of different activities, and the weather was amazing. I gave 5 tours during the month of May to families that were looking for school districts, so it's a good sign that a lot of people are looking at Lodi. And we, after I wrote this report, we even gave another tour the following day. So lots of families really out shopping, looking for different districts. The one person said, I'll come to the first school district where I can find a home to purchase. Every time we go to look for a home in Oregon or Lodi or DeForest, we go to put a bid in on the house and it's gone. So the housing market is moving very quickly for families, and so they're trying to find a house and a school, and so it really is pretty an incredible time. And then I'd like to thank the Friends of Barb Weber. Barb Weber passed away last year at this time, and the Friends of Barb Weber, who are Mary Klein, Karen Kane, Patty Mead, Cindy Mead, Sherry Jimison, Nancy Mitchell, Gail May, Jane Dolphin, and Julie Clark, sponsored an author visit for our second grade students at the public library. They're hoping to make this an annual event in honor of Barb. It was a great day. The students got to hear an author, and they got to make a book, and they got to have a treat. So it was a great day for the second grade students. So I thank those community members for doing that in honor of Barb. Any questions?
Nice. Thank you.
Nice job.
District Administrator report.
Most of the things have already been covered, but I do want to point out that Lodi High School and our special education program that we share with Sauk Prairie Hospital called Project Search got a lot of publicity, and 2 of our students were featured both in our neighboring community's newspaper, and it even got a blurb on one of the local TV stations in Madison. So that's a great program that we just started last year called Project Search. And there's a picture on the website. Music department sent out its dates for next year, so if you're looking to put your calendars together, they're already out there. And also, we received a $15,000 AODA grant from the Department of Public Instruction, which will go toward fostering some of the programs that we've been working on up to this point in time. So that's the only thing that I have to add, which has already been covered by other people.
Thank you. For my report tonight, when we were given the Above and Beyond awards, I think all our staff and coaches go above and beyond every day and probably year-round, even in the communities that they live in. But I also want to remind people that anybody can recommend people to Mr. Purcell, can be staff, community members, parents. If you see someone you feel that's really going above and beyond, to let him know, and we gladly listen to what they have accomplished, and they also get that delicious candy bar. And I want to thank our administrators. I think they're probably ones that we forget to thank. They're for all their time, guidance, encouragement, and knowledge for leading the staff in their buildings and to allow their staff to grow, teach, and help their peers in many ways that people probably don't realize, but it does take a strong administrator to get their staff to work collaboratively and to even not only in their building, but with all our buildings. I'm seeing, you know, with in-service days where people are coming forward and helping out. So I just want to thank everybody for the great job they're doing. Enjoy the summer. Those that have the summer off, I know a lot of people get different jobs, come back refreshed and ready to teach and be ready to go in September with the when the students arrive. I think they arrive in August, though. So next we have committee reports, WSB.
WSAB, there is a summer leadership conference scheduled for July 16th. I don't know what day of the week that is, but it's at the Hyatt Regency in Green Bay. So all board members have the opportunity to take part of the WSAB events. Just let Mo know and she will help set that up. Topics include, obviously networking is going to be always important, but it looks like it's a bunch of topics that are, you're going to get 30 minutes a piece, including updates on school finance, effective board superintendent teams, alternative teacher compensation, legal and policy making, and a statewide legal update. So a lot of topics packed into a very short, it will turn out to be a very long day. So again, that is July 16th. And of course, WASAB also has the webinars. I believe that is you can also utilize that through the WSAB app.
Okay. CISA 5.
Yes, we had our annual meeting, and at our annual meeting we had a presentation on how adversities in our childhood affect our adult life and health. It was quite an eye-opener on some of the things that come about that happen to us as children that affect how we are as adults and diseases we would get, like stress, heart disease, that type of thing. How more likely are you to come up with some of these things if you have these adversities as a child. And then poverty is what brings on most of these adverse conditions as a child. And they had a map that showed how in the last several years in Wisconsin how poverty has grown so much. And I wish our legislature would look at this show us and see this and try to change it. I think they're turning a deaf ear to that too. And then at our last meeting, we gave our superintendent another contract. And we also had an IT report on CISA 5 is partnering up with DPI and the state prisons and using technology in the prison setting for students there also.
Okay, thank you.
And I do have,
That's okay.
I do have that presentation on an email. If any of you'd like to see it, I could send it to you.
Okay. Thank you. Co-curricular report, girls softball ended in fourth place in their conference, and all conference honors went to first team was Kendra Nicolay, and second team was Haley Hellenbrand and Anna Mankey. You know, boys baseball is playing this Wednesday, 6 in Appleton. Wish them the best of luck, and hopefully they'll be playing on Thursday for the championship. Track, Vince had said they sent 15 students up to Stevens Point, and that's a great accomplishment and really fun environment. If you've never been up there, it's fun to go and watch the kids, and you see a lot of great athletes. Accolades to our boys golf team again, placing third at state. You've heard that already. Girls soccer ended 8-0 in the conference, and they lost in their regional semifinals. And they have a first-team all-conference. Savannah Curtis, Cheyenne Schmidt, Sky Barron, and Morgan Kearney made. They all made first-team all-conference. And honorable mention went to all-conference to Kaylee Shields, Amber Richter, Molly Ness, Claire Dutris, Haley Ziegler, Allison Kramer, and Kennedy Hirschlum. And so that's it. OSC.
So at this month's OSC meeting, there was a lot of good discussions about the end-of-year activities that are happening with the kids, as well as the success of the musical, which was very, very successful. But the main topic focused on the lottery. So this year there was a total of 27 third-grade students that were enrolled. The rest are on our waiting list. Of the 27, four of the enrolled are enrolled because of the sibling clause. The fourth grade lottery took place, and there were three fourth grade students enrolled, and the rest are on the waiting list. And fifth grade had two applicants, so there was openings for those, and no lottery was required for that. As of the lottery meeting date, the waiting list consisted of five third graders and three fourth graders. Did that change at all? Do you know?
Yes, we've added another fourth grader.
So, and there was some discussion about there was some mishaps with paperwork, and I think this is an area where hopefully maybe we can start working better together with OSC to get some more consistency across how we do some, you know, enrollments and paperwork and things like that. So more to come on that as I get more into it. But it was a fun meeting. I liked it.
Good. Thank you. Board committee reports, contract review. You saw the results of our last meeting, and our next meeting is this Thursday afternoon at 5:30. Curriculum?
Curriculum didn't meet and won't meet in July. And
August.
August 8th is a...
August 8th at 5.
That's the next one.
Facility?
Facility met twice on June 2nd and June 7th. So everything that was discussed was brought to this meeting today, so you've seen that. There are a couple agenda items left that have to be, that will be on our next meeting, and that is scheduled for, I have that date, August 4th, unless we need to be brought in earlier. I don't know if we do or not. But.
Finance.
I'm going to let Mark speak this one. It should have been my first meeting, but unfortunately I had a family emergency and wasn't able to be
make
there.
You're making me pull up that report. Huh?
Yeah, sorry. Right, I should have given you a heads up.
That's what I can do. I earned my money this month.
Not yet.
Items talked about were, again, some items we talked about today, the two banners. And the banners were, I know that Chuck said that was not a policy. We just, I think the concern of the committee is the amount of management that it takes for those banners. It's a nice thing for the community, and it is a little bit of income, but there's a lot of management. I know that falls on Brent and Tom's teams as well. So we just, I think going forward, we just have to be cognizant about that. Insurance, we saw that today. Athletic passes. The committee took no action on increasing athletic pass costs for the coming year. The rationale was that with the referendum looming, it was decided that to increase student costs, in this case, athletic passes, probably should wait to see what the impact of the referendum is, because we we definitely want to be, which is what we did a few months ago with the general fees for all the schools, where we did hold them constant because we, because the community did pass a referendum. So basically, the decision was made not to change any of the athletic passes, and I think everybody realized that's, even if we were to increase it, those are pretty minimal in terms of our overall budget. Ms. Loken did also present the plan that we saw today, and a future meeting date is set for June 23rd. That's it.
Okay. I can't see policy.
Well, we only had the one. We had no first readings, and we only had the one custodial that's going to be tabled for next time.
Okay. Any future? Future agenda items for our meeting.
Brent and I have talked, and I think we're looking at canceling the Finance Committee on the 23rd, but having a special board meeting on a date that we can get everybody together to just talk about the budgetary issues that we're facing relative to looking at a future operating referendum, how that interfaces with facilities, where we are in terms of this year's budget, but do it as a board special meeting. And I'm looking forward, I don't know if Wednesday the 22nd would work for everybody. It's June. A Wednesday.
In June?
Yes. I know that Sue is going to be gone from the 24th on, correct, Sue?
Yep.
We were looking at that last week, but I'm trying to look to see if we can do it next week.
I can do it.
And what time are we
looking at? All right, that's three
at?
Of us.
I can do it.
Four of us.
Five.
If we met at 5:30, would that work for everybody? 5:30.
I'd have to come after because I'm set up for the concerts in the park.
Okay. If we did it on the 22nd at 5:30, is that okay?
Can we meet at the primary school? Is that possible?
Sure. We'll just post it that way.
Okay. That, unless anybody. No.
As they move furniture out of the classrooms, it's all right. Put into that central area.
How about the library then at the high school?
Library at the high school?
Is that okay? Just a different location.
Yeah. We can
you
do
don't
that.
Like this building?
Well, sometimes it's nice to have off-site meetings. We've done that a few times, and I think it's probably time we do that.
So
it's at the high
library?
School.
Okay.
Library.
All right. So we have a special meeting on the 22nd. At 5:30, and we'll host it in the high school LMC.
And that's open for.
And it's an open meeting, yeah. Okay.
And
so the
no
front
finance.
Doors will be open when I get there later.
Finance.
Yeah, we'll make sure that the doors are open so that people. I mean, it's an open meeting, so people have to be able to get in. So
okay.
We'll have to make sure that works.
What do we need to do to prep for that?
I think it's just having a general discussion and talking about where we are. We've got the Baird information. We've got the budget information that we're closing in on at this particular point. Just an opportunity to have an all-around discussion about the things that we're facing and get input from all seven of you in terms of how we might want to proceed around all these different issues that affect money, obviously.
Bring your A game.
Okay, any questions on upcoming committee meetings? I think they're all listed there. Get those on your calendars. Anything for future agenda items?
And just a reminder, Finance Committee then wouldn't meet on the 23rd because it would be replaced with this meeting on the 22nd.
Someone want to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Who prefers Westfall? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Oh, anyone opposed? Okay, so motion carries 7-0. Oh my gosh. Thank you.